Interested in genealogy? Writing a paper on Frederick Douglass's role as the first African-American recorder of deeds in Washington, D.C.? On this edition of UDC Forum, our guest is Dr. Lopez D. Matthews, Jr., State Archivist and Public Records Administrator for the District of Columbia. In this capacity, Dr. Lopez Matthews serves as the historian of the District of Columbia, chair of the D.C. Historical Records Advisory Board, and director of the D.C. Office of Public Records and Archives. Thank you, Dr. Matthews, for joining us today. It is really critical to know about the archives in the District of Columbia, and many of our residents and visitors don't know. Could you tell us about the archives and its purpose?
So the DC Office of Public Records and Archives is a unit of the Office of the Secretary within the Executive Office of the Mayor, and it was founded in 1986 by a mayor's order from Mayor Marion Barry with Philip Ogilvie as the first public records administrator. And it was started as a home for the records of the government of the District of Columbia. Many of DC's records were housed at the National Archives because DC was a part of the federal government for so long. Then we got home rule in 1973, but DC's records were still going to the National Archives. And so they really decided that there needed to be a home for DC's archives in DC that was controlled by DC. And so they started the DC Archives in 1986. It got its first building in the early 90s, a retrofitted farmhouse on Naylor Court, Northwest, which is where we are still located to this day. And it was at capacity by the late 90s because DC, although it is a city, DC is really a city state and it does all the functions of a state. And so they generate the same amount of records of a state. And so the DC Archives holds documents that, and I know I'm repeating myself with the word documenting, things that document, but it has records that document the way the government touches people's lives. And a lot of people don't think about it like that and they don't really realize how much they interact with the government. Like we have birth records, death records, marriage records, wills. We have records of the court system. We have records from the Department of Health, which deals with people. We have records of all of the district government agencies in our records. And so it's a huge collection. It's the largest collection of material related to DC in the world. And we're right here on Naylor Court. So we've been here for, it'll be 40 years in 2026.
Goodness. I remember having my students and taking my students to the Naylor Court site and having them have the opportunity of having a presentation and being able to just sort of take a look at some items. And I think one of the things that really engaged them was the will of Frederick Douglass. Am I correct?
Okay. Yes, we have Frederick Douglass's will. We have his death certificate. We have a copy of George Washington's will. We have a copy of Elizabeth Keckley's will, who was the main seamstress to Abraham Lincoln's wife. Duke Ellington, we have his birth certificate in the archives. We have a lot of records related to people who are in DC. Some of our oldest records are land records, and they document property transactions in DC. It goes back to 1796. And in there, you also find records of enslaved people because they were property. And so if they were sold as part of the land transaction, they're documented in there as well as property. And so it's a real mosaic of materials that tells the story of DC history.
Do citizens have an residents have an opportunity to, I know I brought my students, but can others go in and do any research or?
So the DC Archives, which is why we need a new building, is very limited in the space it has for research. We do provide opportunities for research. You kind of have to reach out Well, like most archives, you have to reach out beforehand and schedule an appointment. And we need to know what you would like to look at beforehand, because we also have to make sure that it's in the building, because we do have off-site storage facilities, because like I said, we're at capacity. So we want to make sure we actually have what you're looking for. And so we do open for research. We do land record research Tuesdays and Thursdays from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. So people come in to research land records regularly during those days. And then be open for archival research most other days.
Now, as a public historian and moment of transparency, we were Howard University graduate school students in history. As a public historian, what is the feeling when you are in this position, knowing what you are housing and you are coordinating and directing?
Well, I'm just excited that I get to shepherd this archive so that the history can be preserved in perpetuity and made available. Like, I'm excited to be digitizing things. Like, I'm building a digitization program here for the first time. We'll have a digitization program. We'll have a digital repository where you can look at things online from anywhere in the world. And so I got to look at the first birth certificate produced in DC, or look at letters from the city council, or look at speeches of Marion Barry. One of the collections that we're digitizing are the speeches of Marion Barry. And I understood who he was. I knew his importance, but I didn't really understand who he was until I started looking at the speeches that we were digitizing. And looking at those speeches, I'm like, okay, I get it now. Because I'm reading his words, I'm reading what he's telling people. I'm also seeing the places that he spoke at. He was speaking at churches, he was speaking at schools, he was speaking at just regular places, community meetings. And I'm like, okay, he was everywhere talking to everyone and very consistent in his message about DC is this great city. We're building this amazing place. And I said, wow, now I love Marion Barry. And so, but that's the type of thing that I get out of looking through these records. I really, you really get a sense of what DC is about. And that's why I'm happy to be here and happy to be leading this archive.
Now, how do you actually get the documents? Do does the recorder of well, I don't know where the death certificates are they sent to the archives, and the marriage licenses, they're all just sent and then you catalog them and
So, the way it works is we set policies for records management, and the records start with the agencies. And once they become inactive, then they're transferred to what we call the Public Records Center, which is also under the Office of Public Records. And so these records are still owned by the agencies, so they're not open for research, but they're inactive, so they're stored there until they're either destroyed because they're considered temporary or permanent, and then they're transferred into the DC archives. So these records come from the agencies to the Public Records Center, and then if they're of historic value, they're transferred into the DC archives and made available to the public.
And the process of digitizing, I know that's your specialty.
Yes.
And how challenging is that for you?
Well, a lot of people think that you just throw it on a scanner and zip, 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 and it's done. But one of the challenging parts of digitization is that you really have to evaluate the actual documents, because digitization can be very destructive. Sometimes your documents fall apart, and so they're not strong enough to be digitized. And so you have to evaluate what can be digitized, what can be made available. Then you also have to have the resources to digitize it. Digitization is expensive. You need to have the people, you need to have the equipment, you need to have the digital storage. And so it's a lot of different steps that go into it. And that's what I tell my interns who I've used to help build out our digital archive now. I'm like, it doesn't seem sexy. Because you're doing all the minute parts. You're typing. Okay, this is what this letter says. This is what this letter says. This is what this letter says. And it's like thousands of letters. But when you see it on the site, people can be like, oh, there it is. And it's easy to find. And I click here, now I can read it. But I guess I would say the hard part is making sure that we have the resources and the equipment and the people to get it done.
Are you seeing more students interested in archival methods and the procedure? And I asked that because those of us who are historians, I mean, we are under attack. I mean, the whole profession. So the importance of making sure that the documents are there, accurate and factual, so important. Are you encouraged by what you're seeing in terms of students with an interest in this? And how do you promote that? Are you doing any speaking at schools or to get young people engaged?
So I do speak at schools when I'm invited. I talk to young people that I meet. I encourage young people to come work at the archives as interns. That's usually how I get them involved, because they come and they see that it's actually something that is interesting, something that you can make money doing, because they're told, well, you can't make money being an archivist. You can make money being an archivist. You just got to get in the right place. And so, you know, so I just talk to people about it. I go to the student fairs and encourage them to volunteer or encourage them to come work at the archives. And I talk about the interesting things you can find. And so I try to get them that way. So I always say I take them from other majors. Because a couple of my students who've become librarians were business majors. So they changed over once they worked with me in my former life as the digital production librarian at Howard. I convinced them, hey, you know, it's a good field, good money. You don't have to go into business. Work in archives. They may not make as much money, but you will be fulfilled and you will be preserving your history, because that's one of the things that I do highlight is that, you know, historians are great at what they do and they present the material and they analyze it and they critique it, but who makes sure that material is available for the historians? It's the archivists. They're at the front of the line. And if they don't preserve it, you won't see it. If they don't think it's important to save, then it's gone, because no one chose to. Things are only saved because people found it important enough to save it. And that's why, you know, many archives at large are now trying to start preserving records of people of color, because they never found it important before. So they weren't preserving those stories. And now they're saying, oh, there's a gap in the stories we're telling. Whereas HBCUs understood the value of Black life and Black people. And so they saved all of those. They saved the records of Black women. They saved the records of Black men. They saved the records of regular people on the street. And so their lives are documented because they saw it as important, where other archives did not. And then it's important to have diversity in the field because, okay, the documents have come in, but do you understand the importance of those documents that you just brought in? What does this mean? You know, like, I have a pencil here. If this type of pencil was something special in my culture, would someone who's not a part of that culture know that? But I'm a part of that culture and I see that and I go, oh, that's very important. That needs to be saved and that needs to be here. But someone who doesn't know it be like, oh, that's just a pencil. Trash. And it's gone. And so I talk about how that's, you know, the importance of having diversity in the field. And that's why it's important, you know, for us to be there. Because if we aren't there, who's going to make sure that our story is preserved and told?
I do love what I do for a living. I never dreamed that having this career was possible until I came to UDC. I met a professor when I decided to finish up my degree program. She told me, hey, why don't you go and intern on Capitol Hill? The internship led to being a staffer. I would have never been opened up to that opportunity if that professor would have never urged me and said, you know, I see something in you. My UDC experience changed my life. UDC helped me find my possible.
Find your possible. Visit udc.edu/possible to learn more.
There is a major project coming up that you're heading that is going to preserve not only our stories, but the stories of the district residents of the District of Columbia and ancestral records as well. Talk about that project and its connection to the not only to the city, of course, but to the University of the District of Columbia.
So for about 20 years, there's been an idea to build a new home for the Office of Public Records. As I mentioned, the building was at capacity in the 90s. And so there was a big push to, well, not a big push, but a push to build a new home for the Office of Public Records. It took on new life about 6 years ago under Mayor Bowser. And studies were done and forums were done to see what needed to happen for DC Archives. And so they did a study in 2018, and part of that study pointed out that it'd be great to locate that new facility at the University of the District of Columbia, because it is the public university for Washington, D.C. It is a institution of learning and education. The D.C. Archives is an institution of education and study. And so it made perfect sense to place this new building on the campus of UDC. And so when that decision was made in 2018, then the idea said, well, we're building a building here. We're building a state-of-the-art archive on the campus. There are archival collections on the campus. Here's an opportunity to also provide state-of-the-art archival storage and processing space and research space for these collections that are housed on the campus of UDC. And so the plan was to provide space for those programs in the Office of Public Records, because they're on campus and it's going to have a presence on campus. Let's bring in some of the campus into the building. Because it is, and I've reiterated this to people, it is a secure government facility with public functions, because it's also going to have the record center there. And if you remember, I mentioned earlier, the record center is not open to the public.
Right.
And it holds records that should not be made open to the public, because it has, you know, personally identifiable information and all kinds of things. You know, I don't want my business in the street. And I'm a resident of DC. I want my business in there, and I know it's up there. So, you know, we have to be able to protect the records. And so it heightens the level of security for the building. But, you know, we're there on campus. We're open for faculty to do research. We're open for students to do research. They can do research projects using the archives material. That's one of the great things I saw coming from Howard. With the Moore Lisbon Research Center on campus, I see how an archive can be integrated into campus life. And so I see that as what will happen with the DC archives. But also, you know, the university's archival materials are there also. So people be coming to look at that. So that's really what I see.
And what is the, is it going to be a new structure? Is there renovation? Is it the technology being brought in? I mean, that's all exciting.
So the recommendation that was chosen was, there were several options given. And the recommendation that was chosen as sort of the most cost effective and most efficient was the demolition of Building 41, which, you know, the university was already looking to do something else with. And so came to an agreement, studies were done, looked at the environmental structures of all of that. I've read its huge documents and better minds than I have studied this. And so the decision was made to build a new state-of-the-art archive for DC. So it's going to have climate controls. It's going to be LEED Gold certified. which is a sustainability certification. And it's going to provide space, which is most important for archival processing. And so, you know, to have the space to do the work that we need to do is something that we have not had before. So that's really exciting. So like I said, I am a digital archivist. So I've been working to build the digital archive. So we will have our up-to-date digitization equipment, and there's space for that. There's a space for our digital archive to be stored on site. I insisted on that. And then UDC has their research room so that they can still conduct their research. They also have processing space so they can process their records, and they have office space for the archivist to work in. So it's gonna be nice. If you've seen the designs, I think it looks wonderful.
That's great. And it's also one of the ways to support and enhance the significance of having a public institution in the district. And many times, even though the institution has been there for a period of time, there are still far too many individuals that don't know about the University of the District of Columbia. And having the archives there is certainly an enhancement to that, not only benefiting the archives, but the institution as well, especially the critical element of having students engaged and being able to participate as part of either capstone or internships or graduate students. And so it's just a great opportunity going forward. And you talked about gathering all of the collections, and a lot of them were in federal agencies initially. Are there any of our archives outside of the state? As you're smiling.
Yes. There are records in Philadelphia, Boston, and St. Louis.
Oh, goodness. Right. So
you don't have the space to store your stuff.
Yeah. Right.
But other places. So it's in Maryland, Philadelphia, Boston, and St. Louis.
So this project is really going to be a gathering of all of these documents. So you've got a lot to do.
We do. It is a lot to do. We have about 200,000 linear feet of material. No, cubic feet of material. And just to put that in perspective, Moreland Spingarn, which is a very large collection, is about 18,000 linear feet. We're 200,000 cubic feet.
This is going to be quite interesting once
it you...
So when... And I don't want to hold you to any dates or anything of that nature, of course, but are we looking at maybe a 5-year project?
The official date, if you can call it that, is winter 2026.
Okay.
Now, what you call winter is up to you, but the word is winter 2026. But I really hope it's done during this iteration of Mayor Bowser's administration, because she has been a really big supporter of the project. She's been a really big supporter of what we're doing in the DC archives. Mm-hmm. A lot of the support that we've been getting is because she is behind us and she supports us. So, you know, I really hope that it's done during at least this administration.
And as we think about preserving these documents, as you so eloquently said, it's important to have diversity to understand what is critical to keep. And for such a political, hostile climate environment time as this were our history, it really is, I'm very happy that you are leading this to have a historian understanding the critical element of making sure our documents are accurately preserved and then made available where possible for the public to be able to research and to just better inform themselves. We have, as you know, there's this bigger push now to know the ancestors and to know your family members and to be able to confirm what you've been told through family stories that people actually own places and or were owned and freed and those kind of things. So this gathering of these records and having a state of art in the digitalization is just so critical. So as we just, and we will have you back again when this is completed to talk more about this, but just to sum this up, what are your overall view, what is your overall view about the archives and the place it has in the government and just for the rest of the country?
Well, I think that the value of the archive, particularly a government archive, is that it documents the interaction of the government and the people that it serves. It holds people accountable. It documents activities. It documents policy. It documents how that policy was arrived to. Like you said, well, how did this neighborhood change over the years? Well, what were the policy decisions that supported the change in that neighborhood that's documented in the archives? Or, oh, I need a birth certificate. Where did my family come from? That's documented in the archives sometimes. And I would go off on a little tangent. I love going off on tangents. I know you know that. We have a birth certificate, one of the ones that we digitized, and it has written on there that there was a baby born in this location, but they are not allowed to document who the mother is or who the father is. They just document that a baby was born this day in this location. And I said, ooh, that's fascinating. It's probably a senator and their mistress who had a baby. But you have those stories. And there's a report here in the DC archives about the 1968 riots in DC. Mm. They did a hearing and people came to that hearing and they told their feelings about how they felt about DC, what they felt about their life in DC, what the city needed to do to change and what the city wasn't doing. And I read that report and I'm like, wow, you truly understand why they had those riots here in 68 after the assassination of Martin Luther King. You really understand why the city exploded. And we have those records here at the DC archives. And that's really the value of the archive. It tells your story. It tells your history. And while we are through the lens of the government, it's still the story of the residents of the District of Columbia. So that's why I'm excited to be here and excited to preserve it and think it needs to be properly supported. And I'm glad we are in a place where our government does support the preservation of history. And I'll say it that way.
Thank you so much, Dr. Matthews, for being with us, and we look forward to having you back again. Thank you.
Thank you.